This is Jules, and I am back with my, I guess, kind of final installment in these Facebook Lives to get you ready for Thanksgiving. If you are calling on the phone right now, sorry, I can't answer you. I am in my kitchen right now, and I am putting together this recipe for pull-apart dinner rolls that is just so good. I've always kind of wanted a recipe for this, but I haven't had time to develop one. And my friend Michelle over at my Gluten Free Kitchen had been pushing me for a couple years, like, you gotta do this recipe. And it's just been on my very long to-do list, as I'm sure you all have your own very long to-do lists. And it got pushed down to the bottom, and here it is, Thanksgiving. So what do? I ask for help. And I asked my good friend, Chef Patrick Auger, if he would give it a stab, and he came up with this delicious recipe. I've changed it a little bit, but it's basically, you know, Michelle's recipe plus Patrick's recipe plus a little bit of my recipe, and it works amazing. So I'm excited to show y'all today. This is a very new recipe to me too, so I'm gonna keep referring to the recipe. But if you need a copy of the recipe, if you wanna follow along with me, just go to gfJules.com, which is, I think you can see it here, gfJules.com. It's the newest recipe on my recipes tab. It's called Pull Apart Dinner Rolls, and I will be, hi Patrick, thank you again for everything that you did to help make this recipe possible. You're a rock star. I'll be following along with my recipe as well. I just posted it today, so it is a very, very new recipe, but I've made it several times, and I love it, and I've shared with lots of people already, and they love it. Thank you for the hearts. I love that. Thank you very much. We only have a couple left over from the ones I made last night, and these are the ones that are left over, and this is what I think so great about this recipe, too. When you make it with my GF Jules flour, it's super soft, and it's great, obviously, when it comes out of the oven, but it's also still, like, squishy and yummy the next day. So, you know, you could make some great turkey sandwiches with this the next day after Thanksgiving if you have any leftover, or, you know, just eat them as rolls. So I'll set these aside so we have something to eat for dinner. Glad to learn about Patrick through you. Yes. Nadine, Patrick is a great resource. He always has great ideas for food allergy substitutions. And you can find him on Facebook, Patrick Auger, Chef Patrick Auger. So as we go through this recipe, and it's gonna be a little different than the ones that I've done before on Facebook Live, because I am gonna use my mixer at one point in the recipe, just because I think it really does help to integrate the liquids with the flour. But the other ones that I've done, I did, vegetable pot pie, I did two crust apple pie, I did pumpkin pie, which baker's prerogative. I was eating a little bit of pie before the video started, and I'm gonna eat the rest of it when we're over. Like, so anyway, I made the pumpkin pie, and there's not much left, it's really good. And then I did stuffing yesterday. So you can go back in my Facebook Live videos and see all of those videos there and the questions that were asked and the answers that I gave to people. So, hi, how are you, Kimberly? Thank you for coming by. So yeah, I think, you know, you're gonna be ready after these recipes. The pie crust recipe, the stuffing recipe, dinner rolls, and you know, I've got tons of other recipes on my website as well for sweet potato casserole, green bean casserole with fried onions, made homemade gluten-free fried onions, all kinds of, you know, yummy, great gluten-free recipes for Thanksgiving. So you're not in this alone, and you've got several more days to practice, and like the pumpkin pie here, you get to practice and you get to eat all the things you practice. So I encourage everyone to get baking before Thanksgiving, just so that you're not as stressed on Thanksgiving or the day before trying to squeeze stuff in, but also because you get to, you know, sample the goods, you know what I mean? All right, so we're gonna get started, and I hope everybody's had a chance to pull up the recipe. If you haven't, it is at gfjules.com, which is written right here for you, and we've flipped the camera around so you can actually read my website now, so people were getting frustrated because everything was backwards. But yes, thank you very much. I appreciate the hearts and the thumbs up. If you have any questions, please type them in, and as I go, I'll try to answer your questions. If I miss it, because it kind of only shows me a few at a time, then just type it again, and hopefully I'll catch it the next time. At the end, when I post the recipe live, then I will go back and answer other people's questions too. So, all right, without further ado, let's get started in this recipe. The first and most important ingredient is the gluten-free flour. And you'll notice that I use my GF Jules all-purpose gluten-free flour. Oh, I'm so glad you like the flour too. Thank you. Thank you very much, you guys. I'm so glad y'all are loving the flour. To me, it's just life-changing because it means that I can make anything I want to. And that's fun, especially on a recipe or on a holiday like Thanksgiving, where you're using all these recipes from your family, right? You want to be able to use your same casseroles and your same pies. And that's like the pie crust recipe that I made earlier this week. That is my grandmother's pie crust recipe. I just used my gfJules flour. So a couple things about this flour. It is all in. You don't need to add anything. You don't need to buy any funky gums or anything like that. It's all in there and it's perfectly proportioned. And you can use it for everything from like what we're gonna do today, yeast breads, to cookies or cakes or roux. If you wanna make gravy at Thanksgiving, anything, it works great. The other thing about it is it's got a natural preservative in it. So like the rolls on day two, day three, the rolls are still really soft and moist and really, really yummy. When we travel, I always make a big batch of my muffins for my muffin mix. And they're so delicious, but I put them in a Ziploc bag and we'll eat them for days and days. And we don't heat them up, you know, there's no issue. They stay soft. That's why a lot of bakeries use my flour, because they are able to use their same basic recipe, substitute the gluten-free flour in there, and it stays fresh for a while. So that's really great. All right, so that's what we're gonna use as the flour for this recipe. I always weigh my flour, so I have a kitchen scale here, but in my recipes, I try to give you the volumetric measurement of the flour as well as the weight. So if you are like me and you like to weigh it, then the weight should be in there. Not all my recipes have that. All you need to know is that one cup of my flour weighs 135 grams. And if you ever forget, if you go to the top of my website, there's a little, there's a little question mark for FAQs, and that information's in there. As long as you can always get to my website, you'll be able to find them. So we're gonna do 2¾ cups of my flour, which is already sifted, and it should weigh 371 grams. I'll show you for a second though how you measure it if you're gonna use a measuring cup. Do I have one? Here's one. First of all, a lot of people wanna know, how do you keep your flour? I don't keep it in the fridge or the freezer. It's a low fat, low protein flour. It's not gonna get rancid on you. And so even the best by date that's on the products, that is literally the best by date. It is not the expiration date. And I honestly use my products way past that. As long as it doesn't smell funky, you're probably okay. So I keep it in just a plastic container with a rubber top on it, and then I also can see when I'm getting low. And you can see I'm getting low, so I'm just gonna open another bag of the flour. These are 4.5 pound bags of flour. We also have 1.5 pound bags, or cans, which are fun too, because you just put the lid back on. But I like to take a lot, so I always have lots of flour, and I need more than just a can. So, do you need to sift the flour, or is it already sifted? Yes, it's already sifted, so you don't need to do that. If you know you've always sifted your flour, you're comfortable sifting your flour, you like sifting your flour, go ahead and sift it. It's not going to hurt anything, but you shouldn't need to sift the flour. So a canister like this holds one of these bags really, really well, and then I know that I have another 4.5 pounds of flour in there. So if you're, everything's falling over. If you are doing it with a measuring cup, you always wanna make sure you put the flour into the measuring cup like that, because that gives it a little bit of air in with the measuring cup. If you were to instead do this and dig into your flour with your measuring cup, it would actually compact the flour. And this goes for everybody, like not just my flour, or not just gluten-free. If it compacts the flour, it'll throw your recipe off. It can actually throw your recipe off by up to 25%. So if you've made recipes before and they've been dry, or it can, you know, it can even go the other way, it's been too wet, you might be doing that wrong, just a simple measurement, which is another reason why I really like weighing the flour, because it means that, actually I wanna tear it first. It means that I know exactly how much my, of the flour is that I've measured out. So I want 371 grams, let's see here, which is 2¾ cups, as I said before. 271, a little bit more. Almost there. I'm just curious, how many of you guys do measure with a scale as opposed to using a measuring cup? I would love to know. I mean, I'm just a obviously informal survey here. I just love to know, for my own, you know, well-being, I guess I'd like to know how many people really actually do measure it with a scale, or how many people are using the scoops, because I like to know which is handier for people, so I make sure I have that information in all of the recipes. So type in your response if you don't mind, let me know. Like, I measure with the measuring cup or I weigh my flour. Just curious. Okay, so we have 371 grams of the flour, and I'm just looking on the computer here. We're gonna do something a little bit different with this recipe. And we're gonna actually mix the yeast in to the flour itself without waiting for the liquid. You're gonna measure, you're gonna use the scale now, so that's good. Yeah, well, I think, and that's good. I'm glad if you don't have any issues with volume, especially if you're doing it right, then you know that you're measuring it appropriately and it's not a problem. But if you're having some issues with your recipes, you might wanna consider that because it does make it easier. All right, I'm gonna bring my bowl over here. And I'll show you as I'm going, I'll lift it up and show you like that. All I'm going to do is dump this flour that I've measured here into my mixing bowl. And this is a recipe you could mix by hand, but I would suggest that you enlist another family member to take a turn at some point because you do want to mix it for a little while, okay? But we're going to do it in the mixer. I'm going to use 2 packets of yeast. So you've seen these in the grocery store, I'm sure. There are 2 brands that you normally see in the grocery store. It's Red Star and Fleischmann's, and both of them are gluten-free, except for one caveat. There is a Red Star yeast that comes in like a silver container, and it's called Platinum, and it has dough enhancers on it, and that's been grown in a wheat substrate. So you do not want to use the Platinum. You only want to use the regular. Now, I like to use Rapid Rise, or in Red Star, it's called Quick Rise, I think, yeast, because as we'll discuss a little bit more as I go, for gluten-free yeast breads, you don't have all those steps of like kneading, letting it rise, punching it down, letting it rise again. You skip all that stuff with gluten-free, which is, score, much easier and much faster to bake gluten-free, which is awesome. Yeah, Hodgson's Mills yeast is good as well. I haven't had much success in finding a quick rise version of theirs in the grocery store. So these are the 2 that I normally find. So the quick rise allows me to not let these rolls rise for very long and still get the same rise out of it. You could use regular, not the quick rise, and that's fine. You just need to let it rise for longer than my recipe tells you. So if you have one and you couldn't find the other one or something, that's totally fine. Just let it rise a little bit longer, no worries. So we're using a lot of yeast because these are yeast rolls, and you want it to taste yeasty, you want it to smell yeasty, and you want to get that lift too. So all I've done now is I've just poured the yeast on top of the flour, and then I'm going to add a little bit of sugar. Now with the sugar, you can dip your measuring spoon or your measuring cup in with the sugar. This is just a granulated cane sugar. If you're using a scale, yes. And then, yeah, exactly, scales help for that as well, Linda. And that's a really good point for if you have to mix and match. Someone asked me today, your recipe calls for cane sugar, and what if I just have regular sugar? That is regular sugar. I like to use the organic sugar that's less refined because the good stuff that's in sugar isn't taken out as much with that, and so that's what I like to use. But you can completely just use whatever white sugar you find in the grocery store, granulated sugar. There are 2 kinds. There's cane sugar and there's beet sugar. Sometimes you'll see that it'll say it's cane sugar. That's what I'm using, just so you know. But you could use the other and it would still turn out probably just about exactly the same. So this is just a 1/4 cup of sugar. And then we're also gonna add chemical leaveners. Now, these things really need to rise. And so we're adding baking soda and baking powder. And I will tell you, I brought these here today because I wanted to show you. This is probably one you've seen before. I know it's backwards, but Clabber Girl comes in this little container. It's gluten-free, everything's fine. Yes, thank you for the hearts. Well, one day I bought this one because I thought this was Clabber Girl and it was gluten-free and all that kind of stuff. After I used it in a recipe and the recipe tasted nasty, I realized this is baking soda. So they now have a baking powder and a baking soda. So much for, you know, I always read the labels, right? I read it, it said gluten-free, but it didn't read that it said baking soda. So if you're in the store, make sure you get the right one. So baking powder, we're gonna use 2 teaspoons of baking powder. 1, 2, And then just a tiny little bit of baking soda, just a quarter teaspoon of baking soda. All right, a little bit of salt, and then we're done. Well, then we're gonna add the potatoes too, but and then that's all of the dry ingredients we need. So salt, I need what, how much? 1 teaspoon, I think, of salt. You guys could probably tell me faster than my computer. You've done that. Oh, yes. Yeah. See, Patrick, I'm glad I'm not the only one. And Argo baking powder is aluminum and gluten-free. Yes. And there are other brands that you can find in the grocery store that are good as well. It used to be that people would say, oh, you should, you have to look for gluten-free baking powder. They really are all gluten-free now. But all right. 1 teaspoon of salt because salt adds flavor. And then we're going to use this funny ingredient. But I mean, I guess maybe not so funny for Thanksgiving, but it's mashed potato flakes, instant mashed potato flakes. This is the brand that I find in my grocery store, Idahoan, but I put a couple different links in the recipe if you're looking for some or you want to have it delivered. I linked to Amazon so you could get the right one. You have to be careful if you're dairy-free like I am because a lot of them have dairy in them. I haven't found one that had gluten in it, but this one is specifically labeled gluten-free, so I like that. But this is a good one to use. So all I've done is measure out a quarter cup of the mashed potato flakes. And this is gonna, these are just, it's almost like fish food. Like if you ever fed your goldfish this kind of fish food, that's what it's like. But anyway, you're gonna add this one in with the dry ingredients and it's gonna help to give it some texture and some flavor as well. So let's see, I'm gonna whisk that. My whisk is coming apart. All right, I'm gonna whisk that together so that all my dry ingredients are mixed together equally. And then I'm going to add all of my liquid ingredients together and mix those up separately. Now the liquid ingredients are composed of 1 egg, which is, when you're doing yeast, you wanna make sure everything is pretty much at room temperature, and my eggs are obviously kept in the refrigerator, so they're cold. So in order to bring it to room temperature really quickly, because I never think ahead, if you're like me, you don't think ahead, then I put it in a bowl of warm water, but I'm just gonna dump the warm water. Okay, I can see some people are saying they're like me too, yes. And then I'm gonna just crack the egg so that it's mixed, because I don't wanna add it to the recipe without the egg being mixed up itself. Now, if you have an egg allergy or you're vegan, there's only 1 egg in this recipe, so it's super easy to replace this egg with a vegan substitute. I have put in the recipe that I really like with yeast spreads, I like to use flaxseed meal and water as my egg substitute, so I've given you that in the recipe if you need that. So don't worry if you can't do any eggs, that's totally fine. I'm just using it for the example today because a lot of people do want to know how to do it with eggs. So we've got that 1 egg and we have 3 tablespoons of olive oil, which I'm just going to add to my egg. It's just so I can mix that up. And I have 1 teaspoon of apple cider vinegar, which is going to help to activate our yeast. I have a question. Oh, hi, Urs. How are you? How long do you place the egg in warm water, Donna? That's a great question. I place the egg in warm water until I pick up the egg and it doesn't feel cold anymore. It's not super particular with yeast, but yeast grows in a warm, moist environment. So it can't be too hot, it can't be too cold, it can't be dry. So you want the yeast to be in contact when we want to wake it up. We want to wake it up with warm stuff, warm and wet. And so, you know, if you have a really super cold egg, all it's going to do is it's going to mean you need to let your rolls rise longer. It's not going to mean your recipe won't turn out. So that's, you know, just a little tip for what I like to do. So those are the liquid ingredients until we get to the seltzer water. And this is super cheap ingredient here. It's just bubbly water, basically. You could use ginger ale if you didn't mind the flavor that it imparts in the rolls, or you could use club soda. Just any kind of bubbly liquid. The other day, I actually made Oh, I made an artisan bread. That was the other thing I made this week. I've been baking so much this week. I couldn't even remember that I made artisan bread because I took it to ladies' night in the neighborhood right after it came out of the oven, and it was just gone. It was obliterated. Like, I had nothing to come home to my husband with, and he was not amused. But yeah, so I guess I forgot I made that. But I made that with gluten-free beer, and I could have made it with seltzer water, but I used gluten-free beer instead. So artisan bread, another really super easy recipe, and I used my bread mix for that, which you could also use to make a different kind of dinner roll. I have dinner roll recipes on my website using the bread mix. Okay, so where is my other, I had another measuring cup. I'm losing my mind, y'all. All right, I'm just gonna have to get a different one. I need 1 1/4 cups of, or 1 1/2 cups rather, of the seltzer water. I can use this because I've only had it open for a couple days to bake with, and you can still hear the little psst when I opened it. If it was dead, if it didn't make that noise, then I'd want to open another one. So I need to add a little bit more though. Let's turn this around. Ooh, I'm almost at 1 1/2. Bummer. Oh well, let's see. Open that up. The bubbles in this liquid will help it to give it more lift so that the dough itself won't be quite as heavy and it'll raise a little bit better. So the bubbles are going to help with that. I'll just stop by my way down to North Carolina and pick up the pull-apart dinner rolls. Sure, I would love that, Ursula. Anytime, just come on by. I'll make you some dinner rolls just because you're coming. How about that? Deal? All right, so we're gonna add these in, but I'm gonna cheat a little bit just so that it can be mixing while I talk to you. I'm going to put all the liquids in here, and then hopefully you can see me. All I'm gonna do is turn on my mixer, pour in the liquids while the mixer's slowly turning, and then once it's integrated that, I'm gonna turn the mixer up a little bit higher to medium and let it mix for 3 minutes. And I'll come back over here to you closer so we can talk. If you have any questions, this is a great time to ask me because I will be waiting for the mixer to be done and then I can just answer your questions. So let me go over here and hopefully you can see that I'm adding it in just like I said. I like to use the paddle attachment on my mixer. I don't use the dough hook. I think this works much better for integrating doughs, at least gluten-free wise. I use this for almost everything except for something like a meringue, where I would use the whisk attachment. So I use this for cookie dough, everything. All right. So I'm going to turn it on to low and slowly pour the liquid in. So while that's mixing up, I am back over here to answer your questions. Basically, we're gonna let that mix for about 3 minutes, and when it's done, it'll be like kind of a nice, thick kind of a dough, but it won't be too sticky. It'll hold together, but it'll be pretty stiff. And we're gonna use this, which is one of my favorite little kitchen tools, to scoop it out and make them nice and round. But if you don't have this, it's totally fine. Just get a big old spoon and then a spatula and scoop it off into there, and then you can smooth it out. So Bonnie, I will absolutely recap the ingredients. I'll also tell you that this is the latest recipe on my site. So if you go to gfjules.com, you go under recipes, the very first recipe you'll see there is gfjules.com. You'll see is the recipe for the pull-apart dinner rolls. So basically, what I have included so far is 2 3/4 cup of my GF Jules flour. I'm so sorry, I don't have any idea how many calories are in this roll, but you can go on my website under products, and you can scroll down on any of my products and get a nutritional profile for the flour, and then you can plug that in to, there are different recipe apps where you can plug in the ingredients and see how many calories. Thank you, Jeff, for posting the dinner rolls recipe there. So we're using 2 3/4 cup of my flour, I'm watching the time, and 2 packages of yeast. And I use the quick rise yeast, quarter cup of sugar, 2 teaspoons baking powder, 1/4 teaspoon baking soda, 1 teaspoon salt. You're very welcome, Nicole. And 1/4 cup of gluten-free instant mashed potatoes. Funky secret ingredient there. Then for the liquids, I used 1.5 cups of seltzer water, 1 egg, 3 tablespoons olive oil, 1 teaspoon apple cider vinegar. And then it's just mixing up. So it's pretty standard ingredients. Once you have the flour, you can find the potato flakes anywhere in any grocery store probably, but I gave links in the recipe in case you need to find them online, you want to order them. All right, so I'm gonna give it like one more minute, and then I'm gonna go over there and stir it and make sure we're good. The pan that I'm gonna use is a round pan because I think it looks really pretty when they're, you know, the cold part rolls are in a circle. Will a rice flour work for this? No, a rice flour will not work for this. Okay, if you're using a hand mixer instead of a stand mixer, I don't know, I think I might just tell you just to stir it by hand because it's gonna, I've had people tell me some of these recipes before with hand mixers have burned their hand mixer up. And this is kind of a stiff dough when it's finally mixed up. So I wouldn't want you to burn out your hand mixer, and you can totally do it by hand. It's just gonna need to take a breather once in a while and keep mixing. Back to the rice flour question. As I said at the very beginning, this is a very specialized mixture of flours. It's got 5 different gluten-free flours in it. There's a tiny bit of rice flour. It's the smallest ingredient except for a little bit of xanthan gum in the whole flour. And it, if you used a rice flour, it would be really gritty and it would fall apart. And you don't want that in anything really, but you definitely don't want it in a dinner roll. So I would not recommend using a rice flour or using a blend that has a lot of rice flour in it. The way you know that is because when you look at the ingredients on the back of a product, the first ingredient is the one that's the biggest ingredient, all the way down, and then the last ingredient listed is the smallest. How long would you need to mix by hand? That's a good question. Get it as strong, you know, as what that mixer is doing right there. It's incorporating air into the dough as it mixes. So, you know, if you can whip it like that, then I think maybe you can do it for less time. But I would say 3 to 5 minutes. I'll show you what the dough looks like, and then you'll know that's what you need to get it to by mixing it by hand. Asked me on Facebook yesterday, I guess it was, what mixer I recommend if you're going to get a stand mixer. I have had all kinds of different stand mixers, and I love having a stand mixer. The KitchenAids seem to work fantastically, and they just last forever. I will tell you my personal preference is not the kind that has a tilt head where the, you know, the mixer goes like this. I like that kind that raises and lowers, but yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's just me. It's more of like an industrial feel to it, and I'm kind of more used to that, I guess. But oh, I'm so glad that this is the only gluten-free flour that you buy. You've been buying my flour for many years. It really works. Thank you. That makes my heart sing. I'm happy when someone is able to bake what they want to bake again because of my products or because of my recipes. That makes me so happy. Thank you for letting me know that. See, I'm thankful for you on Thanksgiving. Thank you. All right, so I will show you what this dough looks like. And that way you can sort of see where you'd want to get it to be. So it definitely moves, right? But it's not dry. It kind of pulls up a little bit as you're doing that. So if you can see what that looks like. The pictures online, I show you what it should look like when it comes out of the scooper, wherever I put that thing. And you'll see it still has some ridges in it when it comes out of the scooper, so it holds its shape. But it is pretty thick. It's definitely not too thick to stir. You could totally stir this by hand. So What brand of flour do you use, Judy? I am using my gfJules gluten free flour, which I'm so excited to announce was just voted number one gluten free flour again for the third year in a row in the Gluten Free Awards. I'm so excited about that, that you know we're able to make a lot of gluten free people happy. So that's what I'm using, and I don't add anything else to it, so you don't have to add any other gums or anything like that to it at all. Thank you for the hearts and the wows. Thank you. I'm wow too. I'm very excited. Jazz hands. But yeah, so gfJules flour, and you can find it and the recipe at gfjules.com. Thank you, Judy. Thank you so much. We work really hard to make people happy, and it makes me happy when I know that they're happy enough to take the time to vote for me. So I'm super excited. It's not just the flour, but my sandwich bread mix, pizza mix. I think all my mixes won, either number one, or I think maybe one number two or something. So I'm like, wow, I'm so excited. So yay. Again, something else to be thankful for. All right. I'm just going to get my round pan out because I forgot to get it a second ago, and I'm going to line it with parchment. I showed you in the recipe that you can do it without parchment paper. I don't want anyone to go, oh, I can't make this recipe because I don't have parchment, or I don't have a stand mixer or whatever. You can do this without parchment. You can do this without a stand mixer. You can do it. But you do need to have my flour, because otherwise it's gonna be too dry or too crumbly, or you're just not gonna be happy with it. And I don't wanna encourage people to waste their time or their money on something that's not gonna turn out right. So can you get where can you get my flour and my products? If you go onto my website at gfjules.com and you go up in the very top, there's a buy local button. You can see if there's a store near you that carries it, but honestly, most people just order it online, and we deliver right to your door. So that's how most people get it. We wanna make sure people can get it anywhere, because not everybody lives super close to a mom and pop organic grocery store that would carry something cool like that, you know? So we're mostly online. So let me just get my pan real quick. Sorry, I forgot to get that out earlier. A little bit of oil in the pan first. It helps to hold the parchment paper in. If you're not using parchment, you really want to oil this well, and then use some more of my Jules gluten-free flour in there, because if it makes it hard to get out if not. So I'm too much old school, too nervous ordering online yet. Well, Judy, we have actually a lot of customers like you, and we have a phone number at the top of the website, and people call us every day and place an order by phone. And we love talking to people, so just call anytime. And we'll help you with your recipes, and we'll help you order, it's not a problem. So there's a little phone icon on the top of our website. Let me get my parchment out. And the other thing is, if you're gonna flour the pan, I would, again, still use my gfJules flour, because if you use rice flour or something gritty at that point, then your rolls are gonna be covered with gritty stuff. And you just went to all this trouble to make these soft, wonderful, tender rolls, and then you rolled it in grit. Like, don't do that. Same thing with pie crust. Don't roll your pie crust out in rice flour. All right. So, here's my parchment. And this is, I'm gonna put this up here so you can see it better. I think you can see that. Just received more products. I can't wait to cook with them. One of my friends asked me not to use gluten-free flour in making one of my breads. She loved, yes. That is the best, is when you make something gluten-free and your friends have already said, oh, I don't like gluten-free stuff, or your family, especially Thanksgiving, whose family shows up and says, oh, I want to try that gluten-free stuff. If they're not gluten-free, they probably already have a bad idea in their head that gluten-free is going to taste bad. I love making something and they don't know it's gluten-free, and then they're like, this is really good, and then they see you eating it and they're like, wait a minute, what just happened here? And that's the best feeling. Never had any issues with ordering GS. Okay, that's great, Cheryl. I'm so glad that you haven't had any issues ordering from my website online. We try, we spend a lot of money on those safety tools that are online to protect people's credit cards and all that, because we don't want anybody to have any problems, and we don't keep your credit card online, so there can't be any issues later. All right, so I showed you this handy dandy little tool. Most people would call this an ice cream scoop. I call it a dough scoop. And I have found that the easiest way to use this is to get it wet in between each scooping, because maybe it's just mine, it doesn't like spoon out as well or something, but if your scooper is wet, they just sort of flop out really much more easily. So I just have a bowl of water here. I'm just dipping it in warm water, and then I'm going to drive it into the dough here and get a full scoop of the dough. I'm going to start by putting one just right in the middle, and then I can kind of rearrange my parchment a little bit. Putting the parchment in there is nice because when you're done, sorry, I know that's really loud. When you're done, all you have to do is pull it out. You don't have to like go with a knife or on the outside. And I think I mentioned it earlier that I don't plan ahead that much. Well, I also don't like to clean anything if I don't have to. So just a little tidbit about me. I will find a shortcut if I can. So this keeps me from having to clean my pan. Or if I've oiled the pan first, at least all I have to do is just, you know, wipe it clean. So anyway, I'm just scooping these out, and you've got to put them pretty close to each other in order to fit in the pan. You can use anything from an 8 to a 9 inch pan, and then your rolls are going to be have more or less room based upon that. And the pan that I used in the pictures is not here. I don't know where it went, so I'm using a different pan today. So the size of these rolls is going to be a little bit different, but that's okay. So I have one last roll to scoop out, and I'm just going to use my rubber spatula to gather all the dough in the bottom so I don't miss any of this yummy stuff. And spoon out my last roll. All right. Last guy in there. Okay. And they're pretty smooth, but I like them to be a little bit more smooth, if you can see that. I can hold the parchment. You see that? So all you need to do if you want them to be a little bit more smooth is just take that same water that you were using, dip your fingers in it, and just gently smooth out the tops of the rolls. The high points are gonna brown more than the low points are, so you know, just keep that in mind as you're smoothing them. There's no right or wrong. They're going to be amazingly delicious whether or not you smooth them. Doesn't matter. How many rolls does it make? This one is 3, 6, 7 rolls. The ones I had pictured on the website were 8 rolls because it was a slightly different size pan. So I plan for Thanksgiving on at least doubling this recipe because we're going to need a lot of rolls for Thanksgiving. So good question. Very good question. And the other thing about these rolls, I think I said it at the beginning, is that they're still really yummy the next day. That doesn't mean that you want to necessarily bake these the day before Thanksgiving, but you could if you had to. You could bake them the day before Thanksgiving and just warm them up like in a tea towel or wrap them in parchment and then put that in foil and put them in the oven just to get them warm so that you're serving some warm rolls instead of, you know, cold or room temperature rolls on Thanksgiving. Okay, so these are pretty smooth. And then I'm gonna go over it with just an egg wash, but I also gave you a couple other options on the website where the recipe is at gfjules.com. If you are vegan or you're avoiding eggs, there's one egg in here, but I give you an option for how to use that. And let's see, triple it, exactly. I might need to triple it too. Lots of hearts and thumbs ups, thank you. I have given you options to, instead of using an egg wash, to use an apricot jam, like preserves, just thin that with water, or you could use your favorite milk, or you could use oil. The reason why you do this is not just to have like that nice sheen on the top of them, but it's also because gluten-free flour, like especially this one I said at the beginning, you know, I don't keep my flour in the freezer or the refrigerator. You don't have to because it's low fat and low protein. But by the same token, because it's low fat and low protein, there's not really anything in there that's going to brown. And so if I didn't brush these with anything, they wouldn't turn that golden color brown. Have you made them, transported to another house, and then bake? Oh, interesting. No, I haven't. But you could totally make this, cover it really well, and stick it in the refrigerator. And then the next day, bring it to room temperature, then rise it, and then bake it. You could do that. That wouldn't be a problem. So maybe that would be the answer to what you wanted to do. The transporting could be like coming to room temperature kind of thing. If you remember back to what I said earlier about yeast, yeast is a living organism. So we want to take care of it. We want to baby it. But the way we wake it up is with warmth and with water or some sort of liquid. And so if you make it super cold, like you stick it in the refrigerator, it's going to stay asleep. And then you could wake it up later. So put it down for a nap and then you could, you know, wake it up later. Let me just get a tea towel here. So I'm going to brush it with this egg wash that will help it to brown, or you could use like the apricot jam, the sugars in that will help it brown, or you could use milk or your, you know, an oil or something like that. I have tons of recipes for bread on gfjules.com and little, you know, tips like that on different recipes if you're looking for a different type of roll or a different type of recipe. I also have really popular articles on my website about bread baking tips. So there's one called, you know, 18 top bread baking tips. 18. It used to be called like 10 or something, and then I kept adding more to it. So 18 top bread baking tips. There's another one that's specifically about how to use a gluten-free bread maker, or how to bake gluten-free bread in a bread maker that doesn't have a gluten-free setting. What bread makers are my favorites, you know, all that kind of stuff is in there. At work, can't wait to watch when you get home. That's the beauty of this, is that you can watch when you get home, which is nice. So I'll talk more softly so your boss doesn't know you're watching. How about that? So I'm just going around and brushing this on top. And then what I'm gonna do, and this is where some of the more of the experimentation came in, because I've made several batches of these now. What I'm gonna do is put it in an oven that has been preheated to 200, and then I'm gonna turn it off and put these guys in. And then let me show you a little trick, because the first time I did it, I did what I oftentimes do with my breads, which is cover it with a wet tea towel or something like that. And what happened was it stuck, because these rolls have a lot of yeast in them and they have also the chemical leavening. So they went and it stuck to the tea towel. And so when I pulled the tea towel off, they had all these like pox in the top of it where it had risen at different rates. And they tasted fine, but that was not the look I was going for. So basically, actually I'll get another one of these. What I've discovered is if I do it with parchment like this, and then I put another piece of parchment on top of it, then it won't touch the rolls at all, because you see the parchment sticking out here, it's almost like a lid for it. So I'm just gonna, it's so loud, I'm so sorry. I'm just gonna crease it so that it'll stay down. And then when I lay that on top, it's never gonna touch the rolls. So that is a great way of sealing in a lot of the moisture and the heat that's gonna be built up when the rolls start to rise without having anything touch the top. So just a little tip that I found that I really liked. So from now, all that I'm gonna do is stick it in the 200 degree oven, turn it off, stick it in there, and then keep watching it. What I'm looking for is for them to get to the point where they're sort of crowding each other and they're starting to rise. I don't want them to rise a ton, because if they rise a ton, then it's going to be a fast rise and they may get a lot of those little pockets of air that pop when they get to the top, and then they have little pox in the top of it again. So again, it's not wrong, it's just that that's not as pretty as a smooth top roll. So watch it, don't let it rise too fast. If you're just going to set it out on your counter, I would let it set out on the counter for at least 30 minutes or so, but in a warm environment, I would be checking it after probably 15 to 20 minutes. And then if it's about where you want it to be, then you want to take it out, leave the lid on top of it, and then you preheat your oven. We're going to preheat the oven to 450, and the leaving this paper on top seals in the moisture and the warmth so that it doesn't deflate when it's waiting for the temperature of the oven to come up. So when you put it in at 450, then I'm gonna turn the temperature down immediately to 325. I have a super strong convection oven, and using the convection oven, you usually dial it back 25 degrees, but using the convection oven actually made these rolls really brown. So I'm not using the convection setting. If you have a like a more moderate convection setting, then feel free to use that. It works great with breads, but you wanna dial the temperature back by 25 degrees on any settings that I've given you in the recipe. Are there any other questions? That's kind of it. Oh, the only other thing I wanted to tell you is at the very end, if you like, which I think is a really nice thing to do, I take Earth Balance buttery sticks, which are vegan, but you could use butter. When they come out of the oven and right before you serve them, they're warm, I just rub this on the top gently of all the rolls. And it's this beautiful, lovely, like buttery color. It's shiny and it melts and drizzles everywhere and it's just heavenly. So that's the last little thing that I do. Again, you don't have to do that. But if you did want to stick something on top of it, like let's say you wanted to have some fresh herbs on top of it or anything like that, then that would help that to stick to the rolls. So anyway, last questions before we go. Everyone check out the recipe at gfjules.com. Thank you for the thumbs up. I can't wait for you to try them, Linda. I want to hear back from everybody who tries this recipe. I hope that you all love it. And I think, you know, you have the tools now to have a really awesome and tasty Thanksgiving. So I want to hear all kinds of good reports back from everybody after the big tea day. I will check in if there are any other questions. Thanks, Cheryl. If there are any other questions, leave a comment and I will check in and try to respond in the comments there. But I think you're going to love this recipe. Kristen, yay! Yes, that's why I feel it too. I was like, dinner rolls, these are awesome. But there, again, there's other recipes on my site if you want to use a different. There's baguette. There are other dinner rolls. There's a yeast-free dinner roll recipe. There's all kinds of good stuff. So yeah, I'm glad you're adding this to your menu. And please, 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 if you get a chance to bake a pie or bake these rolls or anything before Thanksgiving, you have the added benefit of getting to eat them when you might be fighting over them on Thanksgiving. But also, it will really, really ease your mind because, you know, everyone always says after I do these videos, oh, you make it look so easy. It really is easy, but you're still gonna stress about it until the first time you do it. And then when you do it, you're like, right, that's what she meant, or you know, and then you work it out. You figure your own little tips. Like maybe you have a different thing you like to do for rising them. That's fine. Like, but you've tried it, you've practiced it. So, I'm wishing everyone a really, really happy Thanksgiving. You have the power, you have the tools, you have the recipes. So I hope that you all have a fantastic holiday, safe, happy, and healthy. And stay in touch. Let me know if I can help in any way. Happy Thanksgiving, guys.